Hello friends, today we are going to see the computer aided manufacturing, and in that we are going to see CNC part programming. So we already know that from the computer aided design point we have covered all the drafting requirements, that is the programs regarding the line generation, then circle generation, ellipse generation, then also the two dimensional transformation, three dimensional transformation, and the other aspects such as CSG, that is constructive solid geometry, then boundary representation techniques, and the parametric curves. Okay, all the parametric curves. So that was all part of the computer aided design part. Okay, then we will move to the computer aided manufacturing part, and in that we'll try to first see the important aspects, that is the CNC part programming. So what is a part program? So part program is a series of coded instructions required to produce a part. So what happens is, okay, we have a CNC machine, that is computer numerical control machine, and we supply a coded instruction set to this CNC machine. We do all the required settings as we have mentioned in the coded instruction sets, and then the CNC machine will operate on its own. It will execute these instructions line by line, and it will perform the required machine operation on the workpiece. Okay, on the workpiece. So it controls the movement of the machine tool and the on-off control of auxiliary functions such as spindle rotation and coolant. The coded instructions are composed of letters, numbers and symbols and are arranged in a format of functional blocks as in the following example. So there are various ways how we can represent these coded instructions. One such way is what is explained over here. So it is N10, okay, N10, which is a sequence number. So generally the coded instruction will start from a sequence number, and the sequence number letter is N. Then you will have a preparatory code. Okay, in this particular case it is G01. So it is a linear interpolation mode. Okay, linear interpolation. So this G stands for a preparatory code. Okay, then you will have some coordinates. Okay, so you will have x coordinate, let's say, then you will have y coordinate, and then there will be a machine code which would be called also as miscellaneous code, and then there will be some special codes such as feed rate. Okay, so at what feed the tool needs to move for this linear interpolation mode, that is specified by feed rate. Now this 15.0, that is 15 inch per minute. Okay, so the unit system is up to us to decide. So that all we will see in the coming slides. Okay, so this is just an example of a coded instruction. Okay, one such block of coded instructions. Okay, CNC program is made up of, say, many such blocks of coded instructions. Okay, till the purpose of the machining is fulfilled. Okay, now what we are going to learn here is, we are going to learn the manual part programming. So we will learn all the important aspects of programming. Say there are two basic aspects, such as point-to-point programming and continuous programming. So in point-to-point programming, we cover all the drilling operations, all type of drilling operations, and in point-to-point we cover all the drilling, and in continuous part programming we cover all types of milling operations. Okay, all types of milling operations. In manual part programming we try to learn how to create a basic program. Okay, how to create a basic program. The idea is to understand all the codes and how these codes are implemented. Okay, that is only the idea. Now what actually happens is, you design a part on a 3D modeling tool like SolidWorks. Okay, and then you apply a CNC operation. Okay, you apply CNC operation on a tool like MasterCAM. Okay, and then you create a CNC code by one command, okay, which is provided in MasterCAD, and then you get a detailed program, okay, which may be of, let's say, 700 lines or even 1000 lines or even greater than that, depending on what you are trying to achieve. Okay, so that much complex program we will never be able to create in a manual mode. So in manual mode, we only try to cover a program which is going to, let's say, trace a single contour, okay, trace a contour only one time. Okay, if it is required in actual program to achieve a finished part by carrying out, let's say, 100 such operations or 100 iterations, okay, then the manual program, we only cover it, that is the one iteration. Okay, we only cover one iteration. We don't cover the repetitiveness of the program, that is being taken care by the software like MasterCAD, okay, which gives us a very detailed program with all possible small minor details, and that is why it increases the number of lines of program. Okay, but that's okay, that is the later part. What we are trying to understand over here is how each instruction is used to create a program and bring the desired output, okay, from the machine. So for that purpose we are studying this. So what are the input devices? The program input device is the mechanism for part programs to be entered into the CNC control. The most commonly used program input devices are keyboards, punch tape readers, diskette drivers, and also through RS-232 serial ports and networks. So now slowly, as you can see, keyboard, punch tape readers and diskette drivers, these are gone slightly behind the timeline. Okay, now what happens is each CNC machine is being controlled by a specific computer. Okay, and that computer and CNC machine are communicating through this RS-232 serial port or through any network port. Okay, so gone are the days where you actually had to key in the program on a display device of that CNC machine, where you are provided with, say, limited number of keys. Gone are those days when we used to use punch tapes. Okay, so those days are gone. Even we don't use floppy drives or even compact discs anymore, okay, because everything is now available on a USB device. Okay, so these are pretty old methods of inputting the commands in a CNC machine. Now, since CNC machines are controlled by computers, okay, you can directly work the programs. Okay, you can create very detailed programs using SolidWorks and MasterCAD softwares. Okay, there are many other softwares as well. I am just giving an example, and such programs can be directly fed to the CNC with the use of these RS-232 serial ports or any other network ports. Okay, so it has become very easy and very convenient. Then there is a machine control unit which is called as heart of CNC system, and it is used to perform the following instructions. So when the program is received by this machine control unit of the CNC machine, okay, it decodes or it codes the instruction. It is able to read the coded instructions. Okay, then it decodes the instructions. Okay, then it implements the interpolations. Okay, it is able to read from the code what are the linear interpolations, what are the circular interpolations and helical interpolations and etc., and it generates the axis motion commands. Okay, feed axis motion commands to the amplifier circuits for driving the axis mechanisms. See, it operates on drives. Okay, it operates on, say, the motors, okay, drives, the all other encoders, then amplifiers and etc., all the instruments, all the electronic instruments, okay, that is what the CNC is made up of. So in order to control them, okay, it requires machine control unit. Now machine control unit converts the instructions which are, let's say, in a binary format. Maybe it is receiving at its end, and then it converts it into the motion control instructions, which would be pulsating forms, okay, which would be in a pulsating form, and then sequentially those instructions are given to these drivers, okay, the amplifier circuits, etc., etc., and that is how the CNC operates on the coded instructions. Okay, receive the feedback signals of position and speed for each drive axis. Okay, it is a closed loop feedback system. Okay, so you give instruction, okay, and then you receive the feedback for that instruction, whether that instruction has carried out in a proper way or not. So it is a closed loop feedback system. And implement auxiliary control functions such as coolant or spindle on off and tool change, etc. So not only the drive systems are required to operate with these coded instructions, but also the auxiliary units, like when you are drilling, okay, there has to be a flow of coolant, okay, flow of coolant. When the milling operation is carried out, there has to be flow of coolant, okay, and when the operation is completed, you need to switch off the spindle. When you need to start the operation, first you need to start the spindle, okay. So all these instructions are auxiliary instructions, miscellaneous instructions as far as tool is concerned. So you need to pick up the tool, okay, you need to change the tool. So all these instructions are also equally important and are also carried out by the machine control unit. Then we go to the CNC programming. So what exactly is CNC programming? If we try to look at it, okay, there are different ways in which we can see the CNC program. So one is offline programming, which is linked to CAD program. So that is what we try to achieve over here. So we do a offline program, okay, we do an offline program, we submit the program to the machine, and then machine with the help of its machine control units decodes the program, okay, and then it gives the instructions to all the peripherals, okay. Then there is conversational programming, which is by the operator. So operator tries to do minor changes according to the machine, okay, according to the machine, and then it updates the program, okay, it updates the program. So minor changes, for example, let's say tool numbers or the tool positions, okay, if specific tool positions are not available, or if specific tools are not available, then it tries to change those tool instructions, and it updates the program. Okay, then there is manual data input, that is also possible. So you can also have a manual data input to override some instructions and update the program. Then manual control using jog buttons or electronic hand wheels. Okay, that is also possible if you feel the coded program is not gonna deliver what is expected. Then you can take the control to a manual control and try to do some modifications. And then there is word address coding using standard G code and M code. So these are various ways in which CNC can be operated, CNC can be programmed. So you have offline programming, then you have conversational programming, then you have manual data input, manual control, and then you have word address coding, which is the usual G code, M code, what we generate. Three-dimensional coordinate plane. So when we are talking about, let's say, CNC programming, okay, the programmer has to first know what are the coordinates, okay, what are the coordinate systems that the CNC works with, okay. So see, all these things we are learning so that we can use them on a software, okay. So before using it on software, first you should understand what the software is going to offer. Okay, then only we'll be in a better position to work with the software. So nowadays, no one writes the manual codes. Okay, no one punches the coded tapes. Okay, those days are gone. But now the idea of trying to learn all these things is you need to understand, okay, how the software is generating the code. Okay, why a specific code was generated? Are there any alternatives possible? Okay, so all these things if you are going to operate a CNC machine, if you are going to supervise the CNC operators, okay, then you should know all these things, and that is why we are learning all these things. So X and Y planes are horizontal and represent horizontal machine table motion. So generally XY plane, we call XY plane as a top plane. Okay, so that is the XY plane or top plane of the machine. So if it's a drilling machine or if it's a milling machine, okay, then the XY plane is going to represent the work table. Okay, Z plane represents the vertical tool motion. So on a milling machine, the tool is going to be arranged in terms of Z axis. Okay, it is going to come to and fro, it is going to come down, it is going to move up. So that is going to be the Z axis motion. Okay, that is going to be the Z axis motion. The rotation about Z axis is a tool rotation. It is a spindle rotation. Spindle is going to rotate in a clockwise direction. Spindle can rotate in anti-clockwise direction. So we have special codes for that. Plus and minus sign indicates the direction of movement from zero point along the axis. And four quadrants formed when XY axis cross are numbered in counterclockwise direction. So this is the coordinate system. So you can say this is the origin, okay, origin or zero point. So this is plus X or positive X, this is positive Y, this is negative X, this is negative Y. So this is standard four quadrant system, okay, in a two dimensional Cartesian coordinates. So this is my quadrant 1 where both X and Y are positive, quadrant 2 X is negative, Y positive, quadrant 3 both are negative X and Y, and quadrant 4 X is positive, Y is negative, to two intersecting lines that form right angles. So this is the coordinate origin. See, generally what we do is we try to arrange the part origin with the coordinate origin somewhere over here. So bottom left corner is generally the origin, and then entire part can be represented with positive dimensions. So entire part we try to keep in the first quadrant. That is what we generally try to do when we are trying to write a manual part program which is going to trace the single motion of the tool. Okay, we try to keep all the dimensions as positive such that they are in first quadrant. Okay, they are in first quadrant. This is a generally followed method. Okay, not necessarily, you can keep your part in third quadrant, you can keep your part in fourth quadrant, you can keep your part in second quadrant. Okay, the only thing that you need to look after is the signs. Okay, at that time you have to look after your signs. You can only need to match your origin with the machine origin. Okay, and then everything will follow. Okay, so that is the only requirement. But when we are trying to write a code manually, generally as a standard practice, we take bottom left corner, okay, bottom left corner of your part as the origin, okay, as the origin, and we try to match that origin with the machine's origin. So this is the three dimensional coordinate planes. As you can see, the Z gives the third dimension, which is the spindle axis. Okay, generally it is the spindle axis in the milling machines. So we try to keep our part in this first quadrant. Okay, we try to keep the part in the first quadrant and thereby address all the dimensions as positive X dimension and positive Y dimension. It depends on the Z dimension. If you are trying to do a drilling operation, okay, what depth you are trying to achieve. Okay, what depth you are trying to achieve. So Z is positive as you go away from the plane. So in the upward direction, Z is positive. If you are coming towards the plane, Z is negative. Okay, Z is negative. So that you have to be little bit careful. Okay, apart from that, it is very, very straightforward coordinate system. Okay, then you have machine axis. So every CNC machine tool has sliding and rotary controllable axis. So letters or addresses used to identify each direction of table or spindle movement. So combined with number to form word establishes distance axis moves. Okay, so that is clubbed into an Electronic Industries Association, that is EIA standard. So longest horizontal axis movement is X axis. Y axis is assigned to a perpendicular to both X and Z axis, as we saw in the diagram. Okay, as we saw in this diagram. Okay, so this generally it is the longer movement is X axis. Okay, then Y and Z are perpendicular to X. That's what we have just saw over here. Then secondary axis is parallel to XYZ axis. Okay, ABC refer to rotary motion axis around primary axis. And so with these, okay, we will see how EIA has standardized the block of instructions for a CNC code. So in that, XYZ are primary axis, and secondary axis are parallel to XYZ, and they are generally referred to as ABC. Okay, and ABC refer to rotary motion axis around primary axis. Okay, so we will take an example of each just to elaborate on these points. Okay, we move to the positioning systems. Okay, we move to the positioning systems. So as far as the CNC is concerned, there are two positioning systems available. In defining the motion of the tool from one point to the another point, either absolute positioning mode or incremental positioning mode can be used. So what is absolute positioning? Absolute positioning is what we try to define the part in, that is the actual coordinate system of the part. Okay, and that coordinate system will have a fixed origin. It will have a fixed origin, and all the dimensions will be given in terms of that fixed origin. Okay, so it will be all absolute dimensions. Okay, it will be all absolute dimensions, and that is why this positioning system is called as absolute positioning system. So the desired target position of the tool for a particular move is given relative to the origin point of the program. Okay, and in incremental positioning, the next target positioning for the tool is given relative to the current tool position. So in incremental positioning, the origin is a movable origin. So the current position of the tool becomes the origin, and if you have to move the tool to the next position, so with respect to the current position, you have to just give the dimensions. So it is not following the part origin, but it is following some incremental positioning system wherein current position of the tool becomes the origin. Okay, becomes the origin, and it is for a momentary purpose, or it is for a momentary time. That positioning system we have to define in before the block of instruction is carried out. So initially in the block of instruction, we define which positioning system we are going to work with, and then accordingly the XY coordinates are taken care of. So just take an example. Let's say this is the position where currently the tool is available. Now I have to move the tool to P1, then move the tool to P2, and then move the tool to P3. Now if I have to take these three moves, okay, make these three moves from P0 to P1, then from P1 to P2, and then from P2 to P3, okay, what are the coordinates that I am going to specify with respect to absolute positioning and with respect to incremental positioning? That I will just display. So P0 is situated at 0, 0, which is going to be the origin. Okay, P1 is situated at 12, 12, P2 is situated at 26, 16, and P3 is situated at 38, 32. Okay, now in absolute positioning, it is quite straightforward. It is what I just said. So P0 is 0, 0, P1 is 12, 12, P2 is 26, 16, and P3 is 38, 32. So it is absolute positioning. It is as the part currently or as the required motion currently needs to be captured. So all the points will have their absolute positioning systems. So that means they will have their usual coordinates with respect to the part origin. Okay, now in incremental positioning, what happens? The current position of the tool becomes the origin. So let's say P0 will still remain as 0, 0. Then from P0, if I have to move to P1, my P0 will become my origin. So P1, I have to go by, let's say, 12, 12. So that is also same. But when I reach P1, okay, now I don't have P0 as origin, but now I have P1 as my origin. So if I have P1 as my origin, then from P1 to P2, what the exact distance I have to move? I have to only move, let's say, from P1, if I go 14 in the x direction, I will reach 14 plus, let's say, 14 plus 12, that is 26. Okay, so I will move to this 26 okay, and then from 12 to 16, okay, from 12 to 16, so I actually have to move 4 places in y direction, so that is why 14,4, okay, that is why 14,4, that is the actual distance the tool is going to travel while it is traveling from P1 to P2, okay, it is the actual distance tool is going to travel, okay, so as I reach P2, okay, then I will need to travel, let's say, 12 in the x direction and 16 in the y direction, then I will reach point P3. So this is the difference between the absolute positioning system and incremental positioning system. Okay, both have their advantages, and the advantage of incremental positioning is in terms of the pattern hole drilling. Okay, is in terms of the pattern hole drilling, and if you are using a canned cycle mode. Okay, we will study what exactly we mean by canned cycle mode. So if you have pattern hole drilling, let's say a particular pattern we need to drill, okay, a particular pattern of hole we need to drill on a plate, okay, and there are plenty of such holes. So every time if we start giving the coordinates with the help of absolute positioning, it would be a very tedious job first to calculate all those positions, and then every time to give those positions, okay, so instead of that we do a if there are repetitions, okay, in the program, then we use a canned cycle mode, and in canned cycle mode we can use incremental positioning very effectively to reduce the total number of lines of the program. So incremental positioning has greater advantages when it comes to a drilling operations and pattern hole drilling operations, okay, so we'll see few examples with incremental positioning in pattern hole drilling. Okay, and at everywhere else, wherever we want to follow a contour, let's say milling operation, okay, there we prefer using absolute positioning. Okay, there we prefer using absolute positioning. So we'll take examples of both, and we'll try to understand it in better sense. Then, what is the structure of an NC part program? Okay, so commands are input into the controller in units called blocks or statements. So every line is called as a block, okay, every line is called as a block, and it will start with the sequence number. So it will start with letter N followed by a 3-digit number or 2-digit number, and then it will have a block of instruction, and at the end it will have an asterisk sign indicating that it's an end of block. So unless and until there is an end of block character, okay, that entire block will not be considered as it has ended properly, and then there will be a second block of instruction and the sequence will continue. So you have a block format. There are various block formats, by the way, there are various block formats. So the format which I just explained is part of word address format. Okay, there are fixed sequential formats, there are tap sequential formats, and there are word address formats. So we'll see a quick example of all those three, but mind you, we are not going to actually use the tap sequential format or the fixed sequential format. We are going to use word address format to write manual codes. So assume that a drilling operation is to be programmed as the tool is positioned at 25.4, 12.5, 0 by a rapid movement. So it is going to use a rapid code. So that is G00. The tool is then advanced minus 10 millimeter in the Z direction at a feed rate of 500 millimeters per minute with the flood coolant on. So a very specific instruction is mentioned. So Z minus 10 at feed rate of 500 millimeters per minute with flood type coolant on. Then it is retracted back 10 millimeter at the rapid feed rate, and the coolant is turned off. So initially, the tool is positioned at Z equal to 0 with the specified XY coordinates. Then it moves down to Z minus 10, and then it comes up to Z10. Okay, it comes up to Z10. So in each format, we'll try to see how it goes. So in fixed sequential format, you have a sequence number. Okay, in fixed sequential format, you doesn't have the letters. Okay, we doesn't have letters, it only has numbers, and it has positions where these numbers are expected to be written. So 0050 is a sequence number, 00 is a code, that is G00, then plus that is 25.4. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, first four are for the whole numbers, and the remaining three are for the decimal numbers. So we don't actually give point in between. So it is quite fixed. Okay, in a way we need to write this. So 4 points dot remaining three places. So it is 25.4, then 12.5, then 0, 0. Then here it is 0, 0. Here it is 0, 0. So we don't require any feed, and we don't require any coolant also at this point of time. Then what happens in the next instruction? It is the Z movement, that is linear interpolation in terms of Z. See, XY coordinate remains the same, so that tells the machine controller that it is going to be the Z movement. So as you can see over here, Z changes. So minus 10, okay, at a given specified feed rate of 500 millimeters per minute, and you have flood type coolant on, so it is G08. Okay, and in the next coded instruction, again rapidly it has to come out. Okay, rapidly it has to come out, and again XY coordinates are same, only Z coordinate got changed. Okay, only Z coordinate got changed. Okay, and you switched off the coolant. Okay, you switched off the coolant. So this is the fixed sequential format. Similarly, tab sequential format will have tab. Okay, we'll have tab later explained before every coordinate, before every code. So you have sequence number, then tab 00, then tab X coordinate, tab Y coordinate, tab Z coordinate, tab, then tab 01, then tab. We are not going to change anything, so we can retain only the tabs. Okay, whatever is changing, we'll only write that. So minus 10, then tab 500, then tab 08, and then tab 00, tab minus 0, and tab 09. Okay, for the coolant off. And according to the word address format, this is quite easy to understand. So N50, so sequence number, it starts with N, G00, then X25.4, Y112.5, Z0, F0. So Z is 0 and F is 0. So there is no feed at this point of time. Then G01, Z becomes minus 10 at specified feed of 500 millimeter per minute. And M0, it is a flood type coolant on. And then N70, G00, Z0. So again, it has come back to reference 0. And then M09 to switch off the coolant. So these are various formats in which a same instruction sets are achieved. Okay, a simple drilling operation at the specified XY coordinate. Now, what are the commands? See, there are two types of commands basically. One is a modal command, which when issued, okay, it stays. Okay, it stays unless and until you switch it off. So let's say command issued in the NC program, that will stay in effect until it is changed by some other command, like feed rate, then feed rate selection, coolant selection, etc. So that's what happened over here. Okay, so when I switched on, okay, when I switched on the F500, okay, or you can say when I switched on the coolant, okay, I had to switch it off over here. Okay, okay, when I switched on the feed rate, okay, I was using the linear interpolation. Okay, I was using the linear interpolation. Okay, when I went on to the rapid movement, okay, at that time this feed rate is not followed, but the maximum feed what the machine is allowing, okay, at rapid movement, that is followed. Okay, so as you can see, unless and until we change these commands, okay, these commands stay in effect. Okay, stay in effect. These are called as modal commands, and there are other commands which are non-modal commands, so that are effective only when issued and whose effects are lost for subsequent commands, like a dwell command, which instructs the tool to remain in a given configuration for a given amount of time. Okay, for a given amount of time. So these are some of the non-modal and modal commands. Then what are the informations needed by CNC? So it requires the preparatory information. So preparatory code, that is units, incremental or absolute positioning. Then it requires coordinate information, XYZ, RX, RY, RZ. So XYZ and then rotational XYZs. Then machining parameters, so which are feed rate and spindle speed. Then coolant information, on, off, which type, flood type, mistype. Okay, then tool control, so tool and tool parameters, then cycle functions, type of action required, then miscellaneous control, that is spindle on off, direction of rotation and stop for part movement, and then this information is conveyed to the machine through a set of instructions arranged in a desired sequence, which we call as the CNC part program. Okay, which we call as CNC part program. So what is the block format? So it's a simple sample block which we have just seen, N135G01X1Y1Z0.125 and feed 5. Okay, so restrictions on CNC blocks, each may contain only one tool move. Okay, now each block will contain one tool movement. Okay, one tool movement. Each may contain any number of non-tool move, that is G code. So a block can contain more number of G codes in it, a single block. Okay, but it should only contain one movement. So if I have written XY coordinates once, okay, on the same block I cannot write next XY coordinates. Okay, that is not possible. If I have written Z coordinate, if it's a drilling operation, if I have written Z coordinate, okay, in one block, I cannot again write another Z coordinates in the same block, because two movements in one block are not possible. Okay, but I can have more than one G codes. Okay, in terms of, let's say, positioning system, I have to use preparatory code which are G codes. So let's say G90, G91, G70, G71. Okay, I can use them in a single block. Okay, along with some motion control tools, motion control commands like G01, G00, G02, etc. Okay, each may contain only one feed rate. That is also a very important instruction. I cannot have two feed rates in a single block. Okay, now if I have here set feed rate of 5, okay, then it will have a unit of, let's say, 5 inch per minute, for example, for this program. So the tool is going to follow that feed rate. Okay, tool is going to follow that feed rate unless and until I change the feed rate. And on the same block, I cannot have two feed rates. Okay, that is not possible. Okay, each may contain only one specified tool or spindle speed. Okay, so I can have only one tool getting declared in a block statement, and I will be doing some operation with that tool unless and until I change the tool. Okay, so I cannot change the tools twice, okay, in the same block. So I cannot write, let's say, T01, T02 in the same block. That is not possible. The block number should be sequential. Okay, block numbers has to be sequential, otherwise CNC machine control unit will not be able to read them in the sequence, because it has been instructed that it will read the block of instructions in a sequential manner, and that is why the sequence number has to be proper. Okay, it can be any sequence number, but it has to be in a sequential manner. So N00, N01, N02, N03 and so on. If you are trying to include any instruction in between, then you cannot suddenly change the manner in which we are increasing the sequence. So let's say you want to put instruction between N2 and N3. You cannot add N2.5 in between. Okay, so what you can do, you need to change all the sequence number, make N2, then make N3 as the new sequence number, and whatever was N3 previously, you can shift it to N4, N5 and onwards. Okay, so that is how you should maintain the sequence. Both the program start flag and the program number must be independent of all other commands, okay, on separate lines. So that is why the end of block sign, that is asterisk sign, is very necessary, and every block will start with, every fresh block will start with a sequence number. Okay, the data within a block should follow the sequence shown in the above sample block. So this is a sequence. So you have a sequence number, then you will have a preparatory code, G code, which will define some movement, okay, which will define some, let's say, tool motion. So whether it's G00 or G01 or G02 or G03, okay, linear interpolation or circular interpolation, clockwise, anti-clockwise. Then it will have the destination to reach, okay, so then it will have the coordinates, so XYZ coordinates that tool has to reach. Okay, then it will have the feed information, then it will have the speed information, then it will have, let's say, some more functioning, if we want to specify. So it can be some more preparatory codes, And then at the end, there will be an end of block. Okay, end of block. If required, it can also have M statements, as if it's a tool change, M06T01. Okay, a block can only have M instruction, like tool change. A block can only have G instructions, or a block can only or a block can have combination of G instructions and M instructions, along with the coordinates, along with the feed, along with the spindle speed, etc., etc. Okay, so but it has to be followed in a sequence. So first you will have sequence number, then preparatory code for tool motion, then coordinates, then feed, then speed, then coolant. Okay, then coolant. So that is the sequence in which the block of instruction should be prepared. Okay, now example CNC programs. Okay, so N5, G90, G20. Okay, so this tells us about, let's say, the positioning system. Okay, then we'll see what exactly we mean by G20. So G20 is inch units, as you can see, or it is also used as G70 in general. Okay, so G90, G70 we will say, M06T3, so we are changing the tool. Okay, then M03, so spindle is on in clockwise direction and spindle speed is mentioned, so 1250, let's say, millimeters per minute. Okay, or it is going to be the RPM. Okay, RPM clockwise. Then G00, X1 Y1, so rapidly it has to move to this coordinate. Okay, then Z 0.1. okay, Z is 0.1. then G01. okay, now once I have said only one tool movement, so XY movement I can specify with XY coordinates together. Okay, but Z movement is a different movement, so once my coordinate position is fixed in XY, then I can change Z, and in order to change the Z, it is going to use the G00 instruction. So G00 is a modal instruction. Unless and until I change it, the machine, that is CNC, remains in rapid mode. Okay, CNC remains in rapid mode. So X1 Y1, then Z 0.1, then I am changing it to linear interpolation, so G01. So this is a drilling operation, Z minus of 0.125. okay, minus of 0.125 at feed rate of 5. Okay, at feed rate of 5 inch per minute maybe. Okay, then what happens is, okay, when the generally when these instructions are happening, the drilling instructions, okay, we have to come back to the top surface. Okay, we have to come back to the top surface. So I would include, let's say, one more instruction over here, that is Z 0.1 again, and then I will move to the next position, that is X3 Y2, at a specified feed rate, let's say feed 10. Then again G00, Z1, then X0 Y0, then I will switch off the spindle, and then there will be a program end. So this is just a sample program we have seen. Okay, how the instructions are written. So each instruction to the machine consists of a letter followed by a number. Each letter is associated with a specific type of action or piece of information needed by the machine. Letters used in the codes are NG, XY, Z, ABC, IJK, FS, TRM. Okay, normally we use all these letters. Okay, we'll see when we require to use this ABC, IJK also. Okay, so far we have seen NG, XYZ and FS, TRM. Okay, FS, TRM. We haven't seen yet R also. So while drilling operation is on, we will see this reference dimension, which is generally given for Z dimension. Okay, so these are some of the G codes which are very oftenly used. So G00 is rapid traverse, G01 linear interpolation, G02 circular interpolation clockwise, G03 circular interpolation anticlockwise, G04 is dwell, G08 acceleration, G08 deceleration, G17, 18, 19 are for the plane selections. So generally in all the milling machines, as I said, we will be using G17 for XY plane selection. Then you have G70, G71. Instead of G20, G21, we use G70, G71. So G70 is for inch units and G71 is for metric units. Okay, so we generally go with G71. Then there are some milling operation codes which are generally used. So G40, that is cutter compensation cancel, G41 cutter compensation left, G42 cutter compensation right, As we discussed, G70, G71, then G74 full circle programming off, G75 full circle programming on, G80 that is fixed cycle cancel, that is canned cycle cancel, G81 to G89 are called as canned cycle codes for various operations. So G81 is a canned drilling cycle, then G82 canned reaming cycle, and so on. Then you have G90, which is absolute positioning, and G91, which is incremental positioning. So these are very oftenly used G codes. We may require a few more G codes than this, so we will see them at the time of program. Some miscellaneous codes. Okay, G code is called as general purpose preparatory codes. Okay, and M stands for miscellaneous codes. Okay, so that includes M00, that is program stop, M01 optional program stop, M02 program end, okay, M03 spindle on clockwise, M04 spindle on anti-clockwise or counterclockwise, M05 spindle stop, M06 is for tool change, M08 is coolant on, M09 is for coolant off. Now M07, M08, okay, in some programs, specifically M07 is for flood type coolant, M08 is for mist type coolant, and M09 is for coolant off. Then M10 clamps on, M11 clamps off, M30 program stop and reset to start. So when we want to end the program, we generally write M30 so that it goes back to the start. Okay, it goes back to the start. Now N codes are the identifying number for each block, so it's a sequence number code. It is generally good practice to increment each block by 5 or 10 to allow additional blocks to be inserted if in future, okay, if any changes are required. Say for example N010, N015, N025, etc., so that you can add in between blocks. Okay, you can add in between blocks. Then XYZ codes are used to specify the coordinate axis. As we saw, number following the code defines the coordinate at the end of the move relative to an incremental or absolute reference point. Then there are IJK codes are used to specify the coordinate axis when defining the center of circle. So we will see when we are following a contour, okay, in a milling operation. Okay, if we have to trace a circular let's say arc, okay, then how with the help of G02 or G03 we use IJK codes. Okay, so number following the code defines the respective coordinate for the center of circle. Then FST code we have already seen. F is for the feed rate, example F120. S code is for the spindle speed, so example is S1200. Then T code is for the tool change, number associated with the tool number, so T01, T02, T03, etc. Okay, so this is as far as the initial CNC part programming is concerned. We have just created a basic understanding. Okay, next lecture we will try to start with say few short codes, okay, short programs, say for drilling program, then say a counter boring and drilling, okay, and then slowly we'll try to understand the CNC programming. Okay, we'll first start with the drilling, and then we'll try to do all the types of milling programs. Okay, I hope you have understood the content. Okay, I would request you can if you are like, if you like this content, you can press you can like the video and you can subscribe the video for more such contents, and you can also press the bell icon so that you will get all the updates, okay, as and when I post the new video. So thank you very much. See you next time.